I'm just starting. Yep. Thank you for accepting this in-depth discussion about two, three topics which are really, really important today for the all of the consumers. And I will start directly based on your expertise as a director for the electromobility in the CVT, the Institute Research Institute Center of Geely Group. So based on this, I want to ask you about the plug-in hybrids and the lack of the possibility to fast charge the plug-in hybrids. That's not only for the Geely cars. That's valid for all the plug-in hybrids all around the world. And we want to go, if you accept, a bit deeper into the discussion. What are the reasons? There are technical, economical.
Let's see if I can help you there a little bit. I think this is a very relevant question to ask, especially nowadays when you see a lot of fully electrified vehicles that have DC charging available.
Yeah, exactly.
What if I may be a little bit talk around a little bit first? So
please,
when we start to design a car very very early in a design phase, we start to create, you might say, create the use cases, trying to understand how the product will be used in what kind of scenarios, etc. And that is part of the, let's say, the process that we do when we later on make choices between different technical alternatives. Then we can, in a choice situation, we can go back to the use case and try to understand, okay, this might be better according to what we have, started with. We are not following this, to 100%, but it's a support anyway. And when you come to plug-in hybrids and start looking at the different use cases where you have there, and you quite quickly see that the balance you make inside the car, how big battery, how big ICE engine you will use, etc. All that sort of balance that you create initially, that has an effect on both on what you equip the car with and also a little bit how the car is used. So all this is sort of part of an initial, let's say, process where we sort of trying to define a little bit what to use. And typically the one question to be asked initially or a little bit quite early anyway in this is how should we charge the car? The one what you think, should we have a AC charger or should we have AC charger or AC charger and DC charger or maybe only DC charger? All this kind of stuff. Should we have a powerless charging system, like we did this work with Momentum Dynamics of actually having charging systems where you don't really connect anything, so it's a connective free charging. All these things are in there from the beginning, and then you look a little bit about if we make a PHEV car, then as we did in this case, and the batteries of it's not as big as in a battery for a fully BEV car. We know that the electric range will be lower, even though from this Lynk & Co, we have 69 kilometers of a VLTP range, and that is almost market leading. It's at least quite high in the, so these 69 kilometers, that is quite good. But even though it's less than if you have a fully electrified vehicle, because those will obviously be longer. So that means that probably the use case for a PHEV will be mainly what we see that when you use the electric mode of the car, it will be for commuting. So it's actually going back and forth from home to office and back again, or office or work, whatever. So it's very much a commuting. And then if for longer trips, you will rely more on the ICE engine. And that in that scenario then, that you actually move towards a commuting use case as a main use case, we also think to some extent anyway that the people buying this kind of car, they have the ability to charge overnight or over day. And if you have the whole night or if you have the whole day when working to charge the car, then AC charging is probably sufficient. So that is the main use case that's a little bit guiding us. And then you could of course extend that use and as you propose here, maybe also adding DC charging systems, make it possible to charge during a trip, for instance, when on a coffee break or whatever break you take then by going. The balance you need to do here then about what you put, what kind of equipment you put in the car and the use will be that if you want to do a longer trip, I mean, going from, I don't know, from Hamburg down to Frankfurt or somewhere, I don't know, then you will probably need to do quite many stops if you want to do it fully electric trip. And then that is maybe not the most common way of using a plug-in hybrid, of going fully electric, pure electric drive when doing long trips. Then the combined driveline is probably more efficient or more time efficient anyway for you. I would say even though the car would have had DC charging as well. But still it's always worth of thinking about. But in this balance we did, we believe that it's mainly commuting, mainly for people that can charge a car either while working or while staying at home. So it's a little bit that kind of thinking that behind.
Understood. Tell me, Mr. Wolfsberg, technically, to make it DC fast charging available, it's complicated for such a PHEV.
It's not super complicated. If you look from a design point of view, you have actually moved the charger from outside the car, moved it from inside the car to outside the car, so that you don't need to have the charger available inside the car. So from a pure design point of view, it's I would not say fairly simple, because it's never fairly simple when you go to the details, but it's anyway quite okay design to do that. But you need to do some extra. We are talking then about much higher powers. You need to ensure safety and all that kind of things that are important, of course. You need also to have a communication system so the car can communicate with the charger and sort of, you know, they have this when you attach the car to the charger initially, you have some light maybe blinking and then it turns green or whatever color it turns. That is initially when there's a setup of communication between car and a charger and some sort of handshake of what is it the car can receive, etc. So you need to have that built in also. And so some sort of charger communication device is needed. you need also then to understand if you want to have both AC charging or DC charging, or if you would rely on DC charging only, because if you want to have both, then it becomes complicated in that respect, that you need to ensure that you can package both inside the car, because you are adding components into the car, and that makes it in some areas it could be quite hard to add equipment into that area. So it's from that point of view, from geometrical point of view, it could be also a little bit complicated. But and if you instead choose to remove the AC charger from the car, so you have DC charging only, that is also a possibility, of course. Then you need to understand how you will, because then you have in some aspect moved the complication of charging the car from us as designing to the owner, because you cannot charge at home, for instance.
Yeah, clear.
Unless you create you have your own DC charger too, that is possible, but that is often, those are often still, I would say, more expensive. So you would then let's say move some of the cost from the car to the charger, and that is also, of course, a balance that the user need to take into consideration. But from technical point of view, I think it's manageable. We do it on all electric cars. That's okay.
Perfect. Hmm? Now let's go to the next question.
Hmm?
Let's suppose, because obviously the definition of plug-in you mentioned is absolutely, it's 100% accurate. So let's keep the AC charging and add a DC fast charging capability. And I will say, for the sake of the example of the question, is let's say that make no sense to go more than 50 kilowatts fast charging, because the batteries of PHVs are really small.
Mm.
You don't need, the point here is, while you drink a coffee on a break you have during the time, or your program or whatever, you go to the next city, you have this coffee, and then in 15 minutes you simply recharge the battery. So I guess with 50 kilowatt hours should be more than enough.
Yes.
Now, keeping this, as I said, as an example, that you still keep the AC as it is, you add the DC with for a maximum 50 kilowatts, how costly will be this add-on of the DC?
Oh, that was not a super simple question, Mr. Varde. May I say, it depends on?
Yes, please. Of course.
You know, because if we design this from start, then we would probably have designed some sort of combined DC and AC charger, and sort of from when we put the cables and we do all the communication protocols, etc. And packaging system, etc. Then we would have done this initially, and then that would be a smart way to keep the cost down and also weight down, because that is also important, you know, in a car. So, but from material cost, I know that if you add on instead on top of what you already have, you probably add on, I don't know, is it euro I should answer then, maybe, or something like that?
How much?
No, is it just thinking about the what kind of, or is it euro I should answer in, maybe?
Yes, yeah. In euro.
Yeah, what could it be if you add on the system? Our price to customer would probably be, I guess it would not be less than 500 euros.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that makes sense.
not less than that anyway. Then it very much depends about what is the capacity and what is the, I mean, how we build it in, etc., and that kind of stuff that is connected to that. But I would, not less than 500 then, probably more.
This is in the hypothesis that you start designing both AC and DC from the beginning, or as an add value now after the car is on the market, you can add the DC and it's cost not less than 5.
I am not sure I can make that distinction so exactly, because it depends very much on supplier, etc. So I would say regardless, it will be in that area of answer. Regardless, I would say.
I understand.